Hey guys, welcome back to part 3, and let's get started. After arriving home, I immediately headed to the living room. The broken music box was there. I opened the book I took out from the library and began to study the structure of the music box. Just as I thought, one of the gears was broken. That's why it didn't matter how much I turned the lever, the disc wouldn't turn, and fuss, no sound would come out. But what was I about to do about the gear? Could I make one by following the dimensions? Dimensions listed in this book? No, I couldn't. Dimensions? I don't know. Without any answers, I kept turning the pages. In the back was a list of products shown by the manufacturers, as well as the list of the parts used. When I skimmed it, my eyes fixed on a certain spot. From what I've gathered, the manufacturer of the music box was also made clocks, which meant that they might have used some of the same precision parts in the clock. Unexpectedly, I remembered when I had broken Mad's clock in his shop. That clock, maybe if he has no use for it and he's just going to throw it away, then if I was able to use the gears inside the clock, maybe I could fix this music box. It's probably like, paying me 20 bucks, bro. Just as I was figuring out how to fix it, Shiona entered the living room. Shiona, listen, I might be able to fix this music box using the gears from that clock in Mad's shop. Where's her brother, man? Like, I want to meet him. Shiona's smile looked happier than ever. I could see her happiness from her expression. Oh, come on, man. Fixing a clock is no problem, man. It's not like I'm gonna sweat or anything, man. I'm just sitting out my ass and just turning some notches and stuff. Taking the music box into her hand, Shiona began to sing. It was the same song she sang in the chapel. That strangely nostalgic song. That song made me feel a warm glow in my chest. While Shiona gazed lovingly at the music box, I felt my resolve to fix it strengthen. I wanted to fix the music box for her, and I wanted her to be happy. These thoughts made my chest feel like it might burst. Tomorrow, I'll go to Mad's shop again. Maybe I could persuade him to give me his clock somehow, but there was one thing I was worried about. I was the one that broke the clock in the first place. I had apologized, but that didn't mean that going there would be easy. He'd probably like pay me or something. And just thinking about Matt getting angry left me terrified. My English is so broken, man. My bad, man. And sorry if I'm talking over like the voice lines if you want to hear them. No, I just want to give my opinions. Shiona's words reached me as I wavered. Shiona carried on, as though she was talking to herself, but her words pushed me toward my goal. I was going to Mad's shop once again the next day, and I was going to apologize for breaking his clock once again. Shiona's voice and the music box reinforced my resolve. Alright, back to the old man that gets pissed off. The next day, I went to Mad's shop alone. I thought of turning back countless times along the way, but what kept me going was Shiona's smile. I wanted to look at that smile all day, and that's why I wanted to fix that music box for her. I thought about how determined I was the day before, and about how I could do for Shiona. I made up my mind and stepped into Mad's shop. So like, didn't I tell you not to come back here again? He sure is pissed off. Immediately after, Mad's words rolled over me like distant thunder. I wanted to run away, but I didn't. I wanted to apologize more properly for what I did yesterday. I had Shiona with me then. I wanted to try to do it by myself properly. I'm sorry, but I cannot do that. I'm really sorry for breaking your clock yesterday. I'm really, really sorry. I kept apologizing while keeping my head down. How much time went by like that? Finally, Mad spoke with a slightly softened tone. I did what he said. There stood Mad, with what seemed to be a look of surprise on his face. I'm sorry. Yeah, that is annoying if you keep apologizing. It gets in your head, you know. Although he said that, it seemed to lack the anger from yesterday. I thought I noticed the sound of a small sigh coming from him. Actually, I have one favor to ask. Say, boy, you have some nerve coming here and ask me for a favor? My feet were frozen with fright, but Shiona's words pushed me forward. That clock, will you give it to me? I don't know, that's dumb. You know, like, you broke someone's clock and you want it. It's just like, you scavenged it from them. You scavenged the clock from them. That clock, will you give... Damn! Relax, man. Don't scream at me. A furry is standing at attention like I had just been struck by lightning. It was pointless. I had to give up. Just as I was about to run away, a voice came from behind me. But you gotta pay money for it, like you can't just scavenge it and get it for free. That's what he's talking about. If you just paid him money, then it'll be alright, but you don't. I thought she was at home, but there stood Shiona. Shiona stepped between me and Mad fearlessly. She kept smiling as she explained to Mad. Mad's expression slowly softened and the bright red hue drained from his face. Mad turned away from us, but continued to speak. Man, why did you chuck a day after the wedding? How do you have the time for that? I wouldn't even have the time for that at all, man. Saying this, Mad sat down facing the wall. I bet you any moment there's something gonna bad happen when we go to the factory. Still smiling, Shiona gave Mad a slight bow and left the shop. Thank you very much, sir. I made the same slight bow and left the shop. And then the next day I come back, he's like, what are you doing here again? Didn't I tell you the fourth time not to come back? Poor guy beat me up this time. She informed me as we left the shop. That's the place where you throw away trash, right? If in the outskirts, can't someone just drive to like the bigger towns and get internet and all that? Does Matt take items he finds there, fix them, and sell them in his shop? He's a scavenger, just like me. Picks up items from the garage sales, from the trash and everything. Takes it home, makes a pet house. It made sense, so that was why he had so much old stuff in his shop. He took things that were still usable, and then proceeded to reuse them. Whatever the case, I decided to head off toward the abandoned factory. Shiona, if it's okay, could you guide me to where the garbage dump is? The red children? What does she mean by that? She probably meant the children that talked to her the day before. When I thought about it, she also promised to treat them to soup. No, that's sad, man. You can't just do that. Let the kids have fun, man. Wait one more day. No, don't worry about it, Shiona. Keep your promise to them. My instincts, that's how I get there, man. I'll be like, yep, turn right, go straight, yep, and be like, where the hell am I? Where am I? I'm going to go to the library. I want to look over a map and learn about this area. Shiona's expression seemed to cloud slightly. What's wrong, Shiona? We don't know, but she wants me to come back. That's what I know. Good question. I wouldn't say she hates me. Why? You'll probably hang around her like a lot more, something like that. Yeah, I'll check it out. See you later. That was dull, what I just done. Turning around, I headed toward the library. At the time, her smile seemed a bit off, like it was fraught with sorrow. But I didn't know why. Back to the library, Tipi. Is she still crying? Oh, she's like not crying this time. Tipi was in the same spot. Okay, still crying the same way. Yep, I'm here. Hey, Tipi, can I ask you something? Do you have any maps of the town in this library? Does her parents own this place or something? Great, can you show me where they are? TP couldn't get the words out. What's wrong? Are you not feeling well? But... Sure. No worries. Tipi blushed slightly. Hey man, I'm not a pedophile. And it sounds like I am, but like, cause like, I like little kids. It's like, yeah, I don't want to say anymore. She still looks sad, but her cheeks were a bit rosier. Rosier? Hold you, do you mean like last time? No, it's fine. Come over here. I mean, as in, I like little anime kids, not little kids in real life, but like anime kids. So I think it makes me like a pedophile or something like that, but I don't want to. I extended my arms and she got up and then hesitantly jumped to my chest. I was holding her, although differently than last time. But I thought the same things. Holding her, I noticed how small and soft and fragile she was. Is this okay, Tipi? I don't know, I feel sad because like she looks sad. You know, like, makes me sad. She's sad, I'm sad, everyone's sad. She's crying, I'm gonna cry next time. I'm gonna cry in the next 2 minutes. Tipi began rubbing her cheek against my chest. I could feel my chest grow warm as she did. Was this emotion the feeling of fondness? I wanted to protect this girl. I wanted to stop her tears. I stayed there and held Tipi for a moment. Tipi pointed the way to go while she snuggled against my chest. I followed her directions while I continued to hold her. That's cool. Going to a dumpster. Apparently there's an abandoned factory near the town, and that's where I want to go. So scavenge some stuff, because I'm poor. I'm looking for a part, and it might be there. Yep, you're dead on. Yep, that's right. I want to fix Shiona's brother's music box, no matter what. And then my next mission is find her parents. As I carried her, Tipi led me directly to the shelf that held the book of maps. Did you really memorize where each book is? That's amazing. Did someone teach you? It's sad, because like, she's alone in that very dark library. I would have been scared shitless if I was a little kid and staying in a dark place when it comes to nighttime. After saying the words mommy and daddy, Tippy's eyes began to well up. I was scared of the darkness, man. And now I just go to the darkness like it's nothing. I took out the book of maps, just to change the subject. Sitting down right there, I opened the book. This one also had hand-drawn maps, just like the book about music boxes. Were all the books in this library handwritten? The number was phenomenal, if that were so. Just who in the world had written so many books by hand? I almost felt faint on contemplating the endless stretches of time required for such work. This is pretty beaten up. How old is this book? It's really, 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 really old. One really is just enough. I thought it was a map from decades ago, but the buildings seemed to be in the same locations as in the town right now. There were some pages that were badly discolored, as though tea had been spilled on them. Some were even stuck together. I suspected they'd rip if I pulled on them. I flipped through the pages carefully. Oh, I think this may be it. I found a symbol for the factory, located in the north of the town. Judging by the distance of Shiona's house as well, it was very likely that this was the place. She's crying. I can't leave her. When I see her cry, I'm sad. I don't want to leave her. Tipi began clinging to my neck. I pet her tiny back countless times. Don't worry, I'll be back again. If she doesn't want to feel alone, Shiona could just always take her in, because apparently Shiona doesn't have money issues, you know what I mean? Cross your heart and hope to die. When was the last time I ever heard that? Like, years ago, man. 5 years ago. Yep, I cross my heart and hope to die. I keep promising over and over to Tipi. Why did I do that? Regardless, I felt wrong when I left. A feeling bubbled inside me and urged me to stay there with Tipi forever. I pushed down the feeling and made my way out of the library. I think that's the feeling of like guilt or something like that. As I entered the ruined factory that the map led me to, I could smell oxidized oil. Apparently, this factory is used to produce arms and legs for spheroids. Remember, I call it spheroids, you can call it fireoids, I don't know. There were unfinished spheroids, arms, and legs scattered all around me. None of them had artificial skin applied to them yet, so the machinery was clearly invisible. Visible. Looking closely, I could see that they were built the same as my own right hand. I knew these were just inanimate objects, but it was still a creepy sight. I tried to push away some of the scattered arms with my right hand. The sound of metal hitting metal echoed sadly through the factory. I decided I should come back here if any part of my body were to break. There were plenty of spare parts to be found here. There were several large drums full of oil in the back. Most were oxidized, but there were some unopened ones too. But if I ever ran out of oil, I figured I could come here for maintenance where no one would see me. The farther I walked into the factory, the more my worries seemed to fade away. This abandoned factory was sure to be an important place to me, but I couldn't find the one thing I was looking for. That was, of course, the clock that man supposedly left here. But there was no clocks in this factory, or anything that looked like trash at all. Perhaps the trash was thrown away outside, rather than inside the factory. Or maybe you had the wrong factory. I left the factory for a moment to look around outside. Just behind the factory, I found a whole area piled with high machine parts. Oh, there it is. There was a lot of trash strewn around them among machine parts as well. It must have been the town dump. There were probably more people than just men who came here to look for things they could use. I looked up at the mountain of trash, several times taller than myself. So, where could it be? There was a huge amount of trash. Conducting a systematic search would be a backbreaking job. But there was nothing else I could do. I immediately got to work, starting with a pile at my feet. It's not backbreaking for you because you're a robot. It would be for humans because your back would get sore as. I don't know how long it took. It had been a long while since I felt any sense of time passing. My hands were filthy from having moved the dirty metal plates and oil-covered containers. My clothes were slick with oil, and large stains had appeared all over them. But even then, I continued to cross the carpet of trash, swim through filthy rivers, and bathe under scrap metal waterfalls. Finally, I found it. The clock from Mad's shop, the one I broke yesterday. I found it. I picked it up and watched its hands closely. Of course, they weren't moving. I put it to my ear, but it made no sound. This was only to be expected since I'd broken it. This clock would probably never tell time again. The realization felt like a small stab to the chest. I clutched the clock gently to my body and started walking back the way I'd come. Is there like any bad guys or something?
Okay.
Well, thank you. Sharon agreed to me kindly. I'm back. Here it is. I held out my old stained prize and Shiona smiled pleasantly. Shiona gave me a towel and change of clothes. I wiped off the oil and changed and then went to the living room. Shiona greeted me again there. Yeah, Shiona is really, really nice, man. I don't mind Tipi living here too. I'll make her feel happy because she's like with a family already. No, I'm fine. I want to get right to the work. Right to work. I'm fine. For some reason, I don't feel tired at all right now. Because you're hyped when you find something. When you find something in your house that you lost for like a day, or 2 days, you feel hyped when you find it. Yeah, I know. I'll eat later, so you go ahead and eat now. Shiona left the living room. I watched her leave and then got to work. Whoa, the book. I opened up the book I'd borrowed from the library. This music box was made so that when someone turned the handle, gears of different sizes turned against each other and spinning a disc at a set speed. Apparently, turning the handle faster wouldn't speed up the song at all. I was really impressed by that technology. I followed the book's assembly instructions backwards and took the music box apart. Then I compared which parts were visible. Partway through, I noticed that the drive gear was broken. Due to its high precision, a simple break in just one tiny part caused it to stop working. I suddenly found myself looking at my right hand. First, I would need to search the clock for something the size of the cracked gear. Next, I started taking the clock apart. It's kind of hard to read because like the words are not that like HD. As in like quality wise. I took off the case and used a screwdriver to remove the screws. When I removed the case, I could see the machinery inside. It was full of gears far more precise than those in the music box. One of them, a rather large gear, had a broken axle. That's what prevented it from working. That was probably where I'd broken it yesterday. Matt threw away the clock because there was no replacement gear of the same size. Fortunately, the broken gear wasn't one of the sizes I needed for the music box. Taking things apart made me feel awkward somehow. After all, I had to break the clock in order to fix the music box. Maybe I felt this way because I knew exactly what I was doing. I hesitated a bit, but then took apart the clock as carefully as possible to show it some respect. Like, I kind of make words up. I don't know why, it's just, I go with the flow and I end up making words up. I'm sorry if it doesn't make sense or I sound stupid. I just make up words up, you know. I lined the clock's gears up on the table by size and compared them to the one from the music box. There it is. I had found a gear that was roughly the same size. Now all I had to do was follow the book's instructions and transplant it into the music. Okay. Whoa, that's pretty good. Think this should do it. Now the disc should spin without any problems. I replaced the casing and when I turned the handle, I could feel some resistance. But the handle wouldn't turn. That was strange. What was wrong? I looked back at the book. The parts were correct. And I'd put them in the right places. I tilted my head in confusion and took the casing off again. Then I turned the handle with the casing still off. The gears were definitely aligned correctly. But perhaps because it hadn't been used in a while, the oil was all dried up. Maybe that's why the handle wouldn't turn. What to do? Should I go to Shiona and borrow some of her cooking oil? No, that wouldn't work. Cooking oil probably wasn't the same as oil used to grease gears. It might work at first, but then cause problems later on. So then what should I Then I looked at my right hand. It was covered with a glove, but there were exposed machine parts beneath that. Perhaps the oil used in my own hand would work. I took off my glove and looked closely at my right hand, at the machinery that was now clearly visible. There was oil inside it. To make it move smoothly, I stuck the screwdriver into my palm near the base of my thumb. When I removed the casing, I could see all the machinery used to move my hand, like wires, cylinders, and shafts. There's oil inside of one of those cylinders. It was easily removable to make it possible to replace the old oil. I used my left hand to take out the cylinder and dripped oil from inside it onto the music box gears. I spread the oil around my fingertips to get it on all the gears. Would this work? I put the cylinder back into my right hand and replaced the casing. After hiding my mechanical hand inside the glove again, I nervously turned the crank. At first, it moved awkwardly, but as I turned the handle, the gears began to turn smoothly. At some point, the oil must have worked itself in between all of the gears, and the handle began turning without catching at all. And then that melody started to play.
That's
beautiful melody. Beautiful. 10 out of 10. Shiona suddenly came into the room. Yes, it's fixed, Shiona. Yeah, no problem. It's not that hard. It just took a clock and just took one broken clock, okay? Shiona smiled more brightly than I'd ever seen before. Just seeing her smile like that made a warmth build up inside my chest. And then I noticed, oh, this must be it. This was what joy felt like. In that moment, I felt joy. I was overjoyed to see Shiona smile. And for the first time, I felt like I'd done something useful. Next up, taking care of Tipi. Shiona took my hand and thanked again and again. As her face drew close to mine, I could feel my own grow hot. Hey Shiona, sing it for me. Let me hear your brother's song. Yes, of course. I don't know. I turned the handle on the music box. The melody began to play. Shiona clapped her hands in front of her chest and started singing along with the melody. It was a song she'd been singing when we met. A song had Shiona's brothers wrote. The orange colored song. I felt like I finally understood it. The feeling inside of me, it was joy. Shiona's song. And Shiona's happiness as she sang it. Just watching her sing made me overflow with joy. Shiona sang more happily than ever before. Oh, that's sweet. That's beautiful. That day, Shiona kept singing until she fell asleep. And I listened closely, lost in the song. Shiona asked me again and again to play the song for her. She kept singing until I could hardly keep moving my arm. As I watched her expression, I thought, I want to be together with Shiona forever. If Shiona wished for that too, I could be with her always. But for that to be possible, I couldn't let my true self be discovered. Absolutely not. That day, I was more determined than ever to stay with Shiona forever. The thing is that he's a robot, like, I don't think it'll work out. It was night, and the room had grown dark. As we lay side by side in our beds, Shiona spoke to me. Sure, what is it? Happy? I knew the word itself, but I didn't know what exactly it meant. What was it? A state of being, or was it an emotion? I repeated the word happy to myself again and again in my head. No problemo. Help. What do you want me to do?
Tomorrow,
オルゴールを回してほしい。
And you'll sing, right, Shiona?
え、そう。そして、一人でも多くの人に聞いてほしい。
Oops. Missed a few lines, he goes. Yes, I'd like that too, of course. I'll help. I heard the sheets rustle. What is it, Shiona? All down in the bed together. You know what they're gonna do, like, 10 minutes later. They're gonna embrace. It was too dark for me to see Shiona's expression, but I think she was blushing. You want me to hold hands with me?I'd love to. If I was there, I'd love to. The thing is that he's a robot. She's human. It wouldn't work out unless the love was really strong. I searched through all of my knowledge. I knew that sometimes people held hands, but I thought that held a special meaning for young men and women. Sure, it's fine. If a human, if Shiona wanted something, I wanted to grant it to them.Fortunately, she was to my left. Since my hand covered with artificial skin was on that side, I didn't think it would be a problem. I reached out toward the bed next to mine. My hand felt cold in the chilly room. I searched blindly for Shiona's hand. When I touched it, it felt warm. Shiona's hand clasped my own.
I thought
there was two beds, but sharing one bed, that's cool. Yeah.You're warm too, Shiona. We held hands. Our fingers intertwined naturally without either of us really initiating it. I felt the warmth spread, and it wasn't just the body warmth from our hands. This was different from our artificial warmth. It was a human warmth. It's like they're making love, they're embracing. Like this. And she moaned, I think.I'm sorry, did that hurt?
思った以上に強かっただけ。
How's this?
ありがとう、レイ。
I want to get together with her. We held hands all night long. Our hands were still clapped together when the morning light woke us. Wow, that's some sweet romance. Those things don't happen these days.Maybe they do, but not to me, because I'm lonely. The next day, we filled the plaza with sound. Shiona and I started performing. Shiona sang. I played her brother's music box. At first, no one wanted to buy. But little by little, people gathered to hear Shiona's singing voice. First one, then two people stopped, and soon there was a small ring of them. Not long after, that ring of people grew larger, and the once deserted plaza bustled with activity.Everyone there was entranced by Shiona's song. A young couple leaned in close to each other and held hands. An old woman closed her eyes with deep emotion. A young man gazed at a young lady standing a little ways away. Parents and children laughed happily together. The children were moving their bodies along with the music. Where's Tipi? She should be here, man. They were all listening to Shiona's song in their own way, but they had one thing in common.They were all smiling. Everyone listening to Shiona's song had smiles on their faces. I too felt a warmth deep down in my chest, knowing that I was helping to make all these people smile. I understood. This is what it is to feel happy. The emotion I felt yesterday when I saw Shiona's smile. This is really it. Happiness. I was happy. I felt cheeks lift a little. I must have been smiling.I probably looked a little awkward, but I didn't mind. If it brought me even a little closer to Shiona, that was enough for me. The newly fixed music box kept playing its melody without a hitch. The handle spun easily. The sounds from the disc echoed and were amplified by the wooden box that spread throughout the air. Shiona caught an orange-colored melody, and along with that melody, Shiona sang. I wish this time could continue on forever.This time spent making people smile, and I wanted to keep watching Shiona's happy face as she sang forever. I happened to glance toward the library at the edge of the town. I thought I saw the closed curtains moved a little. For just a moment, I saw a small figure. I knew who it was. that blue girl who was always crying, it was Tipi. She was probably crying now too, all alone in that library. Just thinking about it, it felt a small pain in my chest. It felt like a thorn had pricked me. I wondered how Tipi it felt as she watched this crowd of people, this constantly growing circle of smiles. Everyone here was smiling and sharing the same emotion, but I had noticed one person among them with a scowl on his face. He was mad, with an angry expression and his arms crossed in front of him. He looked completely out of place, and the only one there with an angry expression on his face. As our eyes unexpectedly met, his were filled with an emotion I still didn't understand. It didn't even last a whole second. After an instant, the man snorted, turned on his heel, and disappeared into the crowd. And as I watched him go, I thought, I wanted to make everyone smile, even those who appeared sad or angry. I wanted to give smiles to Tipi and Mad. But what could I do? I continued to think about it as I turned the music box's crank. That was beautiful. Beautiful. After the song was finished, I walked alone to Mad's shop. I couldn't get his skull out of my mind. Oh, he's gonna talk to him. His shop was as dim and gloomy as ever. I stepped timidly inside. There was no customers there. Mad was sitting alone at the register, and there was something strange about him. He wasn't lying back on a chair with legs outstretched as he had before. He was just staring at something he had held in his hand, something square, like a chip. His expression was as stern as ever, but also looked somehow lonely. Mad? When I spoke to him, Mad looked and startled and hurriedly hid the chip inside his hand.
Well,
it is a shop. Barged in, I thought anyone was free to come into a shop. Okay, so now you have to give permission to enter people's shop, huh? It's like going to Wisp and say, hey sir, can I go into a shop? Enter the shop. And I was like, yeah sure man, I got your permission, your permission granted. He was being highly irrational, but for you not even notice me enter, you must have been concentrating very hard on that chip. The chip you're hiding in your head. What? The chip you're hiding in your hand. Sorry, my bad. Damn, he's always angry at me. But I saw it. If you're not hiding anything, why don't you open your hand and... Damn. It's because the protagonist is being stingy. He's like, he's asking. Like, it's none of your business. You know what I'm saying? Pushed back by the force of his words, I was kicked out of Mad's shop. I'd come to try to make Mad smile, but somehow I ended up doing the opposite. Shiona was waiting for me outside of the shop. At the sight of her smile, my chest grew a little warmer. Huh? Why here, Shiona? I came here hoping to make Mad smile, but I just made him angry again. But he seemed angrier than usual today. I'm not sure exactly, but I asked about the chip. Yeah, a square chip that fit in the palm of his hand. Mad was staring at it. I made a square with my fingers to show the size of the chip Mad had been looking at. Shiona must have known something about it, because her eyes went wide. Anyways guys, I'm gonna have to end it here. It's been quite a long time now. I hope you enjoyed part 3. Anyways guys, see you next time. Peace out.